reporting experiences for different publications. She was appointed India's first gender edition for Mint newspaper and continues to write a fortnightly column on gender for the Hindustan Times. Namita, over to you.
Naina has just joined us right on time.
And Naina has also joined us. Naina Lal Kidwai.
Very quick introductions to four amazing women, and there's nothing short, brief, or abbreviated about them, but I'm going to make this fast. Namita Waikar, my namesake, is her latest book is The Long March, which deals with the agrarian crisis and the political movement around the agrarian crisis. She's also the managing editor of PARI. I used to keep calling it PARI, and then she corrected me. She said, no, it's PARI, which is the People's Archive of Rural India, which is perhaps unique in documenting voices that we never hear in mainstream media or in our mainstream discourse. Naina Lal Kidwai is the chairperson of Altico Capital and Advent Private Equity. She is the non-executive director on the board of several companies such as, I'm just naming one, Larsen & Toubro. An MBA from Harvard Business School. She is the recipient of several awards and honors, including the Padma Shri. Also the author of several books, including her latest, 30 Women in Power, Their Voices, Their Stories. Nishtha Satyam is the deputy country representative for UN Women and the youngest deputy country representative across 193 countries. A passionate believer of the urgency to mainstream women across the marketplace, workplace, and community. And Manjima Bhattacharjya has been part of the women's movement for over two decades. She's a researcher, a writer, an activist, and has a PhD in sociology. Her area of specialization includes gender and sexuality and labor and the body. And her new book is Mannequin, Working Women in India's Glamour Industry. Now, this is a reasonably informal session. I'm going to start by asking Manjima to present some opening remarks about the work she's been doing in the glamour industry. Manjima, over to you.
Thank you, Namita, and thank you. It's such a pleasure to be here today. Hello, everyone. I think the framing of this panel, Namita, as we had discussed, is that less and less women are joining the workforce these days. Women are falling off the workforce in India. But when I started my research on women working in the glamour industry as models, the situation was completely different 10 years ago. It was a time when there were hundreds of women coming from small towns, wanting to really try their luck at becoming something big. It was like globalization promised them something that they'd never experienced before. So they were waiting, hungry, at the gates, thinking that the market would open and they would get all these amazing job opportunities and aspirations. And their dreams were really lofty. They never thought that anything would be a barrier. I remember one of the women I interviewed, Mayuri, she came from a village in Assam and she didn't know English. She was living in Delhi for a long time. She was trying to break it in the modeling industry. And what drove her every day, she would think that, look, Gisele Bündchen, who is a Brazilian supermodel, when Gisele went to New York, she didn't know any English, but she became a supermodel. So why should not knowing English stop me, you know? And I was always impressed that her dreams and her aspirations were so they ended up being quite unreal. What happened was very different. Instead, I think what we saw, what I saw happening in my book, that women's experience of work was very different from the way that they had imagined.
Do you want me to continue or stop now?
And I'd say when I look back, there are three things that really make me think that the lives of women models is actually very similar to lives of working women anywhere around the world. Firstly, their work was never really considered work. what they did was always see, you know, it's an extension of dressing up. It's just vanity. What's there? You sashay down the, you know, ramp. There's nothing to it. And I didn't see it either. I couldn't see the labor that they did. But as I worked on the book, I was really able to see what the physical and emotional labor that goes into modeling, the networking and enterprise that it requires to build a brand, to build yourself as a brand, the body work they do. So, and the problem with this is that when you don't see women as working, when they ask for their rights as workers, it doesn't make sense to us.
Absolutely.
You know?
In fact, this kind of invisibilization of women's labor, and of course one doesn't, you know, there is the stereotype of the model having this great, glamorous, wonderful life, and she's traveling first class to all these exotic locations, and it's not really work, it's fun. You know, it's kind of like this glamorous, fun thing. But the work is equally invisible of women right at the opposite end of the spectrum, and that is agriculture and in the informal sector. So what do we understand by this invisibilization of women's labor?
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for being here. The Indian woman farmer, or maybe even women farmers in other countries, their day starts very early in the morning, and what their life is about is they take care of a lot of tasks that are part of farming, part of the dairy farming. India is the largest producer of milk in the world right now, and the credit for that goes to the millions of women who are solely responsible for dairy farming. So they take care of the cows, cleaning up the cow shed, bathing, cleaning the cow, milking the cows, fetching the feed, etc. And then the produce from the cow dung, getting it ready to be used as a fuel, mixing it up with twigs and bits of farm residue. These are all the things that they do related to dairy farming. But the main farming work itself, right from sowing to replanting, to harvesting, to winnowing the grain, all this work is done by women. So about 60 to 90% of the work on farms is done by women. But they don't own the land. The land patta is usually in the names of the men. So that's the reality of women in the agricultural sector.
Right. So just to put a little context, and I apologize, I should have actually done this right at the beginning. And that's between 2004 and 2011, which is the year of the last census, 19.6 million women fell off the labor map. This is cutting across geography, cutting across demographics, cutting across socioeconomic lines. Women just were dropping out of paid work. Amongst G20 nations right now, only Saudi Arabia is better than us, is worse than us, I'm sorry. Everybody else is better than us. And the economic survey of last year says only 24% of women are in the workplace. So female labor force participation is just 24%. And the biggest irony of all is that this frightening drop has come at a time of rising education. More and more girls in schools and colleges. It's coming at a time of economic growth. We're still growing at 7.5%. No matter what we quibble at, we're still a growing economy. So the question is, why are women dropping out of work? And why is it important? Nishtha, do you want to weigh in on that?
Well, I've been asked to strictly not bore audience on a Sunday afternoon with statistics, but being from a bureaucracy, I have to stay true to my mandate. So I am going to use a few statistics, and I think we're talking about a couple of issues bundled up here. So let me just unbundle that. When we talk about women and work, it's an entire paradigm that we are stretching. And let's not forget, 93% of India's workforce is still in the informal economy. So when we say women are dropping out, it's very important for us to see where are women dropping out of. When we talk about statistics, we largely refer to the formal economy. It is true that we have had an annual, about a 10% decline of women falling off the workforce and our workforce participation, and there are differing statistics in the world of statistics. The government says 17, we say 21. Both rather poorly reflect on women's participation in the workforce. The most universally accepted or comfortable and convenient explanation to why women are dropping off the workforce is because they're not in the workforce, but they're in schools, they're in colleges, they're elsewhere. They're doing something that is in the lines of productive work eventually. But when you look at the other side of statistics, it also says that women who are educated are also choosing not to do low-value jobs any longer. So that's a very interesting theory that the World Bank and some of the other neoliberal institutions, along with the UN, are now focusing on, is that women are making a concrete, intentional effort to not pick low-value jobs, which were the only opportunities available to them so far. So interestingly, those jobs where there were low entry barriers, where it was easier to go without a degree, without formal education, there were low-hanging fruits, are opportunities that women are choosing not to do. Now, the reason is, one could go into this, into sociology and say, why would someone who's educated choose to stay back home but not take a low-value job? There are several interesting insights to that. But of course, in the kind of cultural economy that we have that supersedes any other explanation to the economy, when we are educated or when we have a certain access to education, and the very fundamental reasons of why women work in the first place, is important to explain that women, when they're educated, unlike men, do not take up to low-value jobs. They expect decent working conditions that support their social conditions, for them to consider that as a worthwhile opportunity. Because otherwise, the unpaid work at home kind of occupies that their time. If we as a country were to follow an economic model where we calculate unpaid work, it would contribute to the economy as much as manufacturing, automotive, or any other industry did. Just for an example, again, a boring but interesting statistic. While an urban woman spends about 300 minutes a day in handling unpaid work, an urban man spends only 29 minutes of his day on unpaid work. Now, when we look at unpaid work, it's work that is not just not paid for, it is also work that doesn't have a face. So that kind of explains the choices that women make.
And of course, Nishtha, you're being very kind by not saying where India ranks in terms of unpaid work, and which is that we are amongst the worst in the world.
Yeah, the
Indian men
worst.
Actually do the least amount of childcare or elder care, the unpaid work that women must do, and therefore which holds them back from working for money. Naina, as someone who has broken the glass ceiling at a time when there weren't that many women actually in the workplace, what is your experience? You know, the ground reality. What is it that is holding women back from work? What is preventing their advance? And what is it that they need, that one push that they need?
You know, this is such a big question, because the situation changes and depends from industry to industry. But I can certainly comment on corporate India, where India has advanced enormously. And we have had CEOs in sectors, including IT, where at the time when I put my book together, the CEOs of all the MNC, multinational IT companies in India, were women. We've had, of course, a number of bank CEOs who are women. And across sectors, we have had CEOs who are women. So there are enough role models out there today for others to follow. And companies who are embracing women for what they bring in terms of thought leadership and diversity of thinking into top managements. So the corporate India story is advancing well. Can we do more? Absolutely. And the big missing piece in corporate India is women who drop out of the workforce, age, say, between 29 to maybe 35, for reasons to do typically with childbearing, which of course is a phenomenon around the world, and how we can bring them back when they are done with that choice they make of dropping away is something which there is a lot of work yet to be done, but there is attention right now. I think it's going to be far more important for us to focus on the India where livelihood creation brings economic worth to the woman. And some of the work that my husband and I have done with Seva, and the learnings from there are huge. Where the woman, when she learns a livelihood, and it could be being a mason, it's not just doing embroidery, but it's often also that, but being a mason or repairing a cycle or running a solar lantern charging station. The models where women come in, where they are the economic contributor to the family, are critical because then she begins to make choices for the family. And those choices are what change the position of the family. And dare I say, there are much too many men, particularly rural men, who will drink and smoke their earnings away. So rather that money be in the hands of the women. And one of the big spaces of change there has been the microfinance movement, where the lending that happens to self-help groups, which are groups of women which stand guarantor for each other. Not enough to just give them that money. The repayment can happen if the choice of livelihood is also given them in terms of very elementary training and education to be an entrepreneur. And I have seen these interventions work quite easily and very well through some of the activities we did with groups like Mandeshi and others, where you teach the woman a simple trade and she goes from making petticoats in her village to employing 25 women and supplying petticoats into surrounding villages. You teach her the use of her mobile phone, illiterate though she may be, to get a price from the mandis around as to what that vegetable should be priced at, and she gets a better price for what she does. You train her in growing that same seed in a manner which is organic, which happened with a corporate intervention in this case, and she ends up earning 8 times more than what she was earning for the same activity. So the interventions, which are often very simple, and which groups like Seva have done so wonderfully, are what we must replicate across the country. And we will provide huge value creation to the same job she is doing, unpaid maybe, or paid too low, and bring productive value to that.
Yeah. There are two ways of looking at that, Naina. One is, I find that a lot of the skilling programs for women cannot move beyond pickle, papad, and petticoat making. And in a sense, low value, you know. So I don't know which side, so I'm just going to get Namita in. Namita, what kind of skilling is required in rural India where a majority of the women live and work? And what is missing, and how deeply embedded is this skilling, or is it just exceptional stories that we're talking about?
Yeah, hi. One of the things that we spoke about the unpaid work, the National Sample Survey Organization, NSSO, it does a report every 10 years or so. And in 99-2000, there were 35% rural women employed. But in the next report, that reduced to 25%. Now, this decline is also... there are also women, as we discussed earlier, between the ages of 15 and 24, who go into schools. However, there are about 89% of women, if you include the women who also work under what is called domestic duties. So if you look at domestic duties, the number of women who actually work rises up. Now, skilling?
I'm taking from where Naina left off on skilling and entrepreneurship.
Yeah. Now, where skilling and entrepreneurship is concerned, the women who work in the villages, on farms, etc., one big drawback they have is that the land is not in their name. The cooperatives, the farming cooperatives or the dairy cooperatives, the decision makers are all men. There are only about 1/5 of women who are members of such cooperatives. So I think one of the main factors here in skilling them would be to help them participate. So, you know, the education, the training, and maybe formation of more women's cooperatives to get them into these decision-making bodies. And once they get that, they will think of doing new businesses and new ways of enhancing the rural economy.
And I think, you know, you've touched on a very important point here, because a single woman can't solve for this, because a social fabric that does not encourage her to be in the workplace is more likely to see her being battered and bashed back to submission. So there is a need for NGO intervention which brings in community activity. So if you find that there are groups of women that come together and together embrace a livelihood or form a women's cooperative or begin to have a voice, there is far greater chance of success. Mm-hmm. So the sad thing is, this is not going to happen automatically. It is going to require intervention where women get grouped. And that is why the self-help group in microfinance is so interesting, because women are already grouped into these groups. So can we lift their already organized structures as self-help groups into becoming more than just the borrower for the family? And they will borrow initially for health reasons or for a marriage, but rather to help them to borrow for a business or to being an entrepreneur, where of course their chances of repayment go up, but also they become empowered as the economic earner.
Absolutely.
In the family.
In fact, we've seen that in Bihar with the Jivika movement, where women started by borrowing for a small health problem, or the hand pump is broken. And then they're taking loans actually to set up their sons or their husbands. So they would not count in any statistic as working women, but they're financing them. And so their status has gone up within the family. Manjima, you wanted to say something. I saw that urgent look.
No, I think there were several thoughts that were coming to me as you all were speaking.
Yes.
I think it was one of the things that I think Nishtha said is, you know, like, who is dropping out? Who are the women who are actually dropping out? And actually it is, the statistics show us, it is urban, educated, married women mm-hmm. who are dropping out of the labor force. And, you know, you try to avoid using the word choice. You know, a lot of women say that, well, I chose to leave, working when... But I, and this is a very difficult one to dialogue about, you know, when someone says that they left their work out of choice. But, you know, I wonder, would the choices aren't made in a vacuum.
Exactly.
Right. So they're made in a certain context. So if would women make the same choices if working was celebrated and encouraged? In fact, no, I want to take that back. We do celebrate like the first woman pilot or the woman auto driver. If women working was normalized, mm-hmm. you know, if it was the norm, if it wasn't unusual to see women Uber drivers or, you know, whatever, mm-hmm. if it was a normal thing, then women may not make those kind of choices. Mm-hmm. You know, if they didn't feel guilty, leaving their children at childcare, if husbands participated at home in domestic labor, if they didn't have so many conditions.
Right.
You know, the participation in the workforce is so conditional for women. You know, if you can get up in the morning, finish the housework, then you can go to work. If you can come back, and even in the West, if you can earn enough that surpasses childcare costs, then you can work.
Absolutely.
So it's completely conditional, the participation.
Absolutely, completely. And I hear that even from in families where the daughter-in-law is an IIT graduate and a topper, and they say, but roti to tumko banani padegi. You know, and she internalizes that message, oh my God, I'm not there for my children's homework, and ends up, you know, how do you see that?
No, I just want to respond to a couple of things that actually, I have several thoughts. I did actually avoid the word choice, and that's a great observation. The reason I avoid the word choice is because it again puts the onus of everything on the woman herself. And people wouldn't make the same choices if all things were equal. Now, I'm very encouraged by what Naina said, that the corporate sector has slightly different trends from what the rest of the country does. But the truth is that the corporate sector still has, by its own measures, a 30% wage gap. So even women who are choosing to be role models are choosing to be role models on a certain cost, because they have to be there. And even if it's at the cost of earning lesser for the same work and for the same talent, it seems to be okay because it's more important to exist. On your question on skills, now I find it a little surprising. Whenever we talk about more women in the workforce or more women in the parliament or more women anywhere, there is a condition of performance. Somehow we believe that all the men in the workforce are skilled. All the men in the parliament are totally equipped to be there. It's not true. So I think we have to start from a standpoint to say that it is not default setting that 50% of the population is outside the workforce. It is not because they don't have the skills. It's because they have not had equal access to opportunities that have given them a chance to display those skills or learn those skills or hone those skills. But an interesting conversation that I think a lot of panels on women have not been having is the introduction of technology, is artificial intelligence. I think when we talk about artificial intelligence, we think a robot is actually going to walk our way and do something and speak in a language that we've seen on TV that we don't understand, and that eventually is going to cost us our job. I think the banking sector is a good example of how artificial intelligence has pretty much replaced frontline functionaries completely. The greater worry that the UN has, or even I have, is when AI dawns on us much more than it has right now, it will be easier to write off women because they're already at the margins, at the periphery of work. But the other side of the conversation, which has been a bogus conversation for years together, is women don't do very well on IQ, but are great on EQ for some reason. It's the most unscientific argument ever. If that's the case, then with artificial intelligence, boy, we sure have a good chance.
So on the skilling part, I just want to mention a few things, you know. And Manjima mentioned that how things are working against women because, you know, as long as everything else is taken care of and you do the rotis and do the homework with the children, you can go and work. Now, in the farming sector, all the tools that are used, whether it's the hammer, the sickle, and the spade or anything else, they are made in such a way that it's made for the male grip. Okay, so we have to start over there. We need to make these where women can use them. The tools have to be designed for women. I remember reading an article many years ago, I think it was in Economic Times, where the woman had written this article about how cars are also designed only for men.
I have an interesting interjection at this point of time. So DTC buses, DTC has one woman bus driver, one. And of course, she's held up as this great exception. But why is there only one? Because the buses are designed for people with a minimum height of 5'6". The seats cannot be adjusted. So you've designed them for men. So there's one woman driver because she's tall. But your average woman is not going to fit that bill. Naina, so and then...
If I could just come in on the very important point of unequal pay. And there's a very interesting little piece on Netflix, Unexplained, which talks about the unequal... Why are women paid less? And the interesting fact that it throws up is, and this is around the world, that women of equal education tend to be paid the same as men up to the point when maternity leave, etc., comes in. And then the statistics change because, whether you call it choice or whatever, but they're moving away from the workplace, maybe it's flexi hours, part-time, whatever, creates the unequal statistics. So if that is so, at least the desire for equal pay and equal education and equal pay, equal contribution and equal pay at the initial stages suggests that we are in the right place. So then the whole issue is how do you bring the woman back into the workplace in a way that she can catch up and again be back on
Absolutely.
The same statistics. But one of my worries is, so, you know, there's a new policy on 6 months maternity leave.
I was just going
and
to ask you.
Statistics around the world show that this, in fact, becomes a burden around the woman in the organization, because the organization begins to rethink why it should hire more women, where it would have to bear this burden. And the Scandinavian countries have shown the way that you have to bring in paternity leave at the same level. So the burden, so-called burden of hiring women and men is the same, that there is no discrimination upfront that, hey, because the woman will get this leave, it's going to be an issue in terms of cost as we go forward. So sometimes we think we solve for a problem, but indeed create a problem where we will see more women falling away from the workplace because they are in fact not going to be hired by corporates who see it as a burden rather than a gain.
Right, Nen. And the problem that I personally have with 6 months maternity leave, not that I have a problem with it because everybody should have 6 months maternity leave. It is great. I'm not against it, but it reinforces a stereotype. So when you're saying as a government, as a policy measure, that maternity leave 6 months because that is a woman's job and paternity leave zero because, well, men aren't concerned, you're reinforcing a stereotype. So the prime ministers give up your LPG scheme. It's always the woman who's making tea in the background. And maybe that is the social reality. But surely at a policy level, you can have the man making a cup of tea. It's not a genius thing to do, making a cup of tea. So Manjima and then Nishtha, if you could come in.
You know, I think part of the problem is it's not actually about men and women. It is about having workplaces that humanize the worker, you know. Human beings, we work, we live, we have children, you know, we have problems. But at the workplace, there's a pressure to be strong. You can't be weak. Your vulnerabilities cannot show in the workplace, you know. And I remember one of the women I'd interviewed, she was being fitted for something and she cut her finger and she was bleeding. And she told me the story very proudly that she got out of the dress before the blood could stain the dress, and she was said to be very professional for not tending to herself first before and thinking more for the dress. And I thought, but you know, that's not something to be proud of. I mean, you know, we are all human beings. It sort of shows that for us workers, whether it is the corporate worker or the farmer or the woman model, they're essentially instrumental. I mean, they're just workers. They're not really human beings. So we really need to humanize the workplace in order to be able to address the multiplicity that life is, really.
Yeah. I don't know whether this is a generational problem, but my generation of women was very apologetic about everything. I'm sorry I'm pregnant. I'm sorry my mother has died. I'm sorry my kid has a board exam. I'm sorry. And you know, we were very hesitant about asking for money that was due to us, that meant. So I think this generation of women is definitely more assertive and good for them. Nishtha, would you agree with that?
Well, a couple of points of reflecting on the things that were said. I do think it's genius when someone, man or woman, makes a good cup of tea. So I slightly differ from that. I absolutely agree with you. I think it's not just a matter of how women are treated. I think how women are treated at the workplace is a derivative of how employees are treated at the workplace. And therein are built some very incompatible versions of what's a good woman at home and who's a good employee. And there's some sort of incompatibility on how we culturally define it. But I think the base argument here is we are asking for all things equal without nothing disturbed. And I think that's an unreasonable ask. What we're essentially saying is that the workplace should be a place where all things are equal without disturbing any cultural assumption. And let me just read out to you, again, boring statistics, but I'm from the UN. No. This is not female only. I have male colleagues who will apologize later for the same thing. Sorry. This is as per a 1,000 household survey that was undertaken by Oxfam in the states of Bihar, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, and UP. And the results speak to cultural assumptions. 53% of people, men and women, who took the survey, both across urban and rural spaces, said that it was okay and acceptable to criticize a woman if she failed to care well for the children. 60% felt it was harsh, it was okay and acceptable to criticize a woman if she left a dependent or an ill adult unattended. And 42% said she should be beaten, this is again in rural spaces, if she failed to fetch water or fuel wood for her family and deserved to be criticized harshly. Now you see, we cannot ask for all things equal with nothing disturbed. When we redistribute power in a workspace, in a community, in a household, it is an uncomfortable position to be. And that's why we strongly believe that men, women, elders, children, all need to play a role to come out in the front and say, this is going to be uncomfortable for us for the next decade or so, but we are going to go through this because we want a better world. Can we do this by setting only maternity leave? We cannot. Because we have to allow, again, we also have to stop seeing men just purely in the frame of perpetrators. We have to start seeing them as partners. We have to allow men to live a life at workspaces and otherwise that reflects the variety, the range of the life that they actually live and not just look at them as bread earners. So I think that's where the big change is.
I want to just add to this, because Nishtha is so right in that the social change is so important. But the change also has to be us as women, where I can think through my 35 years, I remained consumed by guilt every time I was not there for any one of these duties. And what is going to change that? That our own guilt at not delivering on those same social conditionings has to also change. And it almost has to be simultaneous, where there has to be like a womanhood or motherhood that comes together and says, hey, I will not be guilty about these things, because in fact, there has to be a shared role in the household.
And then just to add, patriarchy is that monster that we're all fighting, but let's also remind ourselves that patriarchy has an extremely rewarding side when you succumb to it. It has an extremely rewarding side. When you exactly do what patriarchy wants you to do, you go back home, you're the good girl. It's a nice feeling for the first 2 seconds, right? So we have to create rewarding workplaces. We have to create rewarding systems. We have to create peer groups where we continuously talk to each other and say, we are only going to break this if we break this for all. And let's remind ourselves, when we speak about gender inequality, we are not just speaking about a better world for women. We're also talking about breaking those stereotypes for men, for transgenders, for all other communities, because it's going to be a more equal workspace to be in.
Right. Namita, I want you to come in and weigh in over here on this, what Naina and what Nishtha are talking about, the internalized message. How internalized is it in rural India, where women, as you said, work incredibly hard, they wake up at 4 in the morning. A lot of times you ask a woman, do you work? And she says no, and then you ask her to describe her day, and then she has this day that, you know, is frightening.
Yeah, I'll pick out on one story that we have on PARI, that's ruralindiaonline.org. This is a story of from Osmanabad district, where the women have to fetch water because there's a water shortage. Now, there are also men who do this work. They would carry 6 pots of water on a motorbike, and they would probably make 2 or 3 trips in a day. The women would carry 2 pots of water and they would make multiple trips. They would walk about 15 to 20 kilometers daily. And if that is not enough, the daughters in the house would join the mother in fetching the water. You have probably also heard of this concept of water wives in some villages. Yeah, in some villages there are men who have a second wife whose only function is to fetch water. So the criteria of choosing the second wife is that she should be strong physically so that she can fetch water regularly, and she's younger than the first wife and she has no other social rights or responsibilities. So her only job is to fetch water. Yeah, that.
I want to change tack a little bit because I just suddenly looked at this clock and I got a fright because I want to leave some time for audience question and answer. sexual harassment in the workplace, Me Too India, it's been a hashtag, it's been in the news. Does it have a bearing on women's participation at work? I'd like all my panelists to weigh in, starting with Mahima, whose work is actually in the glamour industry and with models. How prevalent is this casting couch? You talk about it a lot in your book.
So I think the women in the modeling industry, I mean, the casting couch is much more Bollywood sort of a term. I think sexual harassment, as women who I interviewed experienced it, it was certainly very difficult to talk about. When I did the interviews, it was not, if I did the interviews today, I'm sure there would be many more stories that would come out. And that's really a testimony to the kind of silence that the Me Too movement has broken. But I think women in the glamour industry additionally face a lot of stigma around the work they do, because they have to, it's a very high cost of actually being a model. They are often prejudiced as being dumb, as being available, as being loose women. So it's actually an amplification of what, you know, women in general experience. So if something happens to a woman, often it's said she asked for it, you know. And we know the backlash against that has been huge. I mean, I think since 2012, this understanding that women have a right to public spaces, they have a right to wear what they want to wear, that voice has become really strong. But women models face the extreme of that, you know, of that kind of attitude towards them. I think more than the Me Too movement in today's day and age, it is the, you know, there was another hashtag called I Believe. You know, this environment that people will believe women when they say something has happened to me. And they will not question her, they will not judge her. I think that's what has actually played a really big role in addressing, in actually open up space to have this conversation. In my book, I think there's a range of harassment that women face that ranges from the everyday harassment that women face in this country to very specific violence, which is because they are models, not because of what they do really, but because of the prejudices associated with modeling.
Right. Do you want to weigh in on Me Too?
Well,
sexual harassment.
Yes, I think it's important. We usually pick sectors when we talk about sexual harassment. I do want to say, based on our work, sexual harassment is all pervasive. In a moment of honesty, I must also confess that the UN has just released a report on the environment within the UN, and one out of three employees have said that they have been sexually harassed at some point, which is an extremely disturbing statistics for a rights-based organization. But it goes a long way to say that sexual harassment is a reality for women on an everyday basis, irrespective of where they work. It's great that movements like Me Too are expanding the way they are and catching momentum the way they are. It's important that women are speaking up. It's important that women speak up with accountability. It's also important that we listen and we believe, because that's where the change will come from. I don't think we ask for too much evidence when men speak, because we believe that they are coming from a point of credibility and responsibility. I don't know any reason why it would be otherwise for women.
Absolutely. When we talk of Me Too, we're not really talking about the 94% in the informal sector who are systematically, I won't even say sexually harassed, but raped by supervisors.
Yeah. In rural India, I would like to bring in a new angle to this. Rural women, even the illiterate ones, they've been talking about sexual harassment since centuries. On Pari, we have this collection of grind mill songs, and I'll just quote one of those songs in which the woman says, "Which fool decided to give birth to a woman? I would rather be a tulsi plant who gets more respect from the society." I think that, in a nutshell, explains, you know, what the rural women feel about their being a woman in the villages of India.
Naina.
What else can I say except that the good news is that through POSH, through the Vishakha Committee norms, at least in corporate India, there is a policy which has to be adhered to. It comes with very serious repercussions if not adhered to. There is training to be provided for those who do this. And at the end of the day, I would like to believe that if properly followed, and there is clearly still a gap, that women in corporate India will get at least a due hearing and right action because of that constitution. But the worry is for all those women out there in unstructured industries, the industries that don't have
a corporate policy. Actually, I want you to come back to corporate, because the debate really is that due process is broken. And a very high profile case on which you were the board member was Terry and Pachauri, where the trial has not even begun 3 years after the complaint was first filed.
But see, there's a court process. I'm not referring to a legal process. If someone goes to the courts, then the courts will have
no,
to
rule.
No,
she went to the ICC.
No. So, Nena, but no, I don't want to get into this. But let me tell you that where there is an internal committee system, and the internal committee is allowed to operate by law, within a period of 3 months, the IC has to state what its position is, right or wrong. The woman can go to court after, by all means, but the IC should be allowed to opine. And where the IC has opined, and I can give you hundreds of cases on this, the corporate board or CEO has no right to overrule. That has to be followed. So the law, in terms of policy, is very clear if the IC is allowed to operate. For the woman who goes to court, and she is absolutely right to do it, and she has no recourse if she is in industries which aren't organized. And the problem really is that today, the cases that are coming out in media and in the industries you talk about, or maybe even Bollywood, the guilds, the associations, they don't have this system which clearly sets out what needs to happen.
I know you don't want to talk about
but I'm saying that there has to be a process.
There is a process.
Must be followed, and where it doesn't exist, it needs to be put into place. Because when it isn't in place, the Me Too movement takes over, and the Me Too movement
is great.
So that is
exactly my question, which is the failure of due process. Because you may not want to, but this is something that has been reported. In the Terry case, the complainant did go to an ICC. An ICC was constituted. It found against him, and yet nothing happened. He was not even asked to resign.
Not correct facts. Within a week of it going to the IC, she went to court. So the court
she filed a police complaint because she had no faith.
It was
and,
in
and
the
courts. And as you said, that was her right to go to
it
the police.
It was in the courts. So I'm just saying the IC should be allowed to operate because it is the body which can act. The minute you go to the courts take over, and the courts may rule right at the end of it. They still haven't ruled.
Well, that's my point. Court,
but that is the issue.
So
I am telling you my advice to any woman who has an issue, rely on the IC initially, because the courts will give you the right at the end of the day, but they take too damn long. So we have to have a process by which the corporate rules and the corporate cannot ignore
what the IC says. I agree with you. We need a process. Maybe we all need to put our heads together. This system is broken. So we have actually very strict laws, whether on rape, whether on asset violence, whether on sexual harassment. But on the ground, they don't always work. Is all I'm saying. I'm going to have just one last round of question. If you had a wish list, wish can come true, what is your prescription for getting women into work? One quick round and then we'll open it to the audience. Manjima, starting with you.
I mean, there's a long list of things, but I think at the heart, it's really about making sure that ambition is not a dirty word. You know, really encouraging our girls to have ambition, to really want to do, to aspire, to dream, you know. Because it's not, working is not just about economic contribution, contributing to the nation, contributing to the household. It is also about growth as an individual. It's about work transforms you. You know, it changes you. It's joyous. You know, and I'm reading a book right now called Factory Girls, which I'd recommend to everyone, by Leslie T. Chang, about girls in China, the masses of girls who are working in the factories in China. And they work in terrible conditions. It's awful. They live in terrible conditions, but they're having the time of their lives. Absolutely. Because working really, it is something that changes us and that moves us and makes us grow as individuals.
Right. Nishtha, your prescription, getting women back into work?
I think for a start, when we talk about women, we should stop prescribing. I think that's where we're going wrong. So I don't want to use the word prescriptive. I think that's what we shouldn't be to women. But as a community, we could come together and lower the opportunity costs that women have just to be themselves, just to be at work. I think that would be something that we do, not just for ourselves, but for the country that we live in and the world that we will leave.
Yeah, I think the one thing I would like is for parents to bring up their sons and daughters as equals. And for Indian men, you know, we need to normalize the work of domestic work and childcare work and elderly work. We need to normalize it for men as well as women, and not only for men, only for women.
I agree with everything that our panelists have said. I don't think I could have said it better, but I do think we need due process to be followed and instituted across sectors as they don't exist today.
With that, I'm going to open it to, so can we have two mics out so we can quickly, here. Yeah, and please tell us who the question is addressed to. Can you get a mic here to the lady here? Hanji, aap puchhe. Kiske liye sawal hai?
My question is to all of you.
All?
All of you.
Okay.
You see, there's already acute problem.
You please have to hold the mic close.
There's acute problem of unemployment, yes, in this country.
Yes.
If women are going to be educated and you want them to be inducted,
okay,
into employment in the corporate sector, government sector.
So taking away men's jobs.
Where will the men go? Number two, please listen to me. The question of Shuzi, training the males to do the household chores is also one of the important points which you should lay stress upon.
Yeah. So I didn't know jobs come with a male-only stamp, but thank you for that. Nishtha, you want to reply?
Sir, ye desh ka yahi kamal hai ki mard badi jaldi dar jate hain. Abhi to humne baat karni shuru kari hai. Dariyega nahi, we are not going to take anything from you. We are going to take only things that belong to us any which way.
Over there, so he's going to ask the next question.
No, and please, very short questions. We just have 7 minutes. It won't go beyond 7 minutes.
Go ahead. So I have a question regarding affirmative action or like quotas. So I've had the privilege of working in all sorts of elite places, studying in all sorts of elite places. But what ends up happening is the credibility takes a hit. So wherever I go, I work in the West, even there. Somebody or the other will tell me that you're here because we have a KPI that the company needs to follow. They need to have a certain number of women here. So what do you have to say about quotas for women?
Naina, would you take that?
So, you know, I was for years someone who said quotas will have the backlash you describe, because people will say, hey, she got there not because of ability and merit, but because of a quota. So, but having said that, I think as an organization, you have to set a target. So what I like is to say that in 5 years, this is what we would like to see, so that it's more directional and it's less about the quota. But having said that, given how pathetically slow that journey can be, I'm so glad that we established that at board level, there should be at least one woman. It's a ridiculous one. It should be 30%. But at least that has forced women onto boards, because otherwise you hear the most ridiculous reasons. There aren't enough trained women. But heck, for every guy who got there, he wasn't a director till he got there either. So how was he trained? So I do think we need to have a quota at times. And I think reservation in parliament might be a good starting point too.
Yes, absolutely.
My question is open to all. I am working with an NGO and is working for women empowerment. And they provide the skill to women all day. But you all work, you all said that the male are the responsible for the breakout. But I am the counselor there, and the women says to properly that I can't work regularly because my mother-in-law, my mother, my girl, they said, why tum kyun karti ho, tum hi ho kya sari duniya ka theka tumne le rakha hai, tum should ghar baith jao. To uske liye aapka kya reply hai?
Manjima wants to answer that.
Yeah, I think you're referring to the thing that women themselves block other women. So I think Nishtha referred to something called patriarchy or pitrasatta. So it's basically like a game of sap siri, you know. So if you go ahead with whatever patriarchy says, you'll go up the ladder. And if you go against, then you'll come down the ladder. So everybody plays this game. It's not just men who play it. It is men and women who play this game. And, you know, I think it is... the truth is that if the woman does go to work, maybe her mother-in-law will have to do more work. So until we bring the father-in-law or the husband into the picture and really look at it as a complete picture, it's not fair to say that they're going against one
Nishtha
another.
Nishtha wants to add to that.
Sir, ye pitrasatta samaj mein jo saas ka bhumika hai, ye 99 ka saamp hai. Lekin suniye meri baat. Ye aurat hi aurat ki dushman hai ka jo dialogue hai, ye kaafi outdated ho chuka hai. Because jo सास है वो भी किसी और समाज से नहीं आई है उन्हीं को उन्हें हमने ही ग्रूम किया है सो आई अगेन लेट्स नॉट टेक अपॉर्चुनिटीज टू पुट द ओनस ऑन वुमेन हु आर नॉट वर्किंग फॉर वुमेन द आइडिया इज द एंटायर इकोनॉमी एंड द फैमिली सिस्टम नीड्स टू कम टुगेदर टू इंश्योर दैट एवरी
सॉरी प्लीज इनको
आपका एक प्रश्न था आपने पूछ लिया
और फिर एक सवाल और हम पूछ लेंगे प्लीज
आई वांट टू क्विकली से वन थिंग This dushmani between Saas and Bahu is actually related to the fact that the property is owned by the men.
Absolutely.
You know,
absolutely.
If the Saas was owning the house absolutely. And the property, she would not be so possessive of her son and her husband being in control.
Absolutely. Who's got the mic?
Hi. I basically had a question about guilt, and I think it manifests through the perpetuity that we see in the system. I wanted to ask the other side of it, which is when we talk about more girls in schools and we don't see them still coming into the workforce, what is the gap here we're talking about? Is it actually the discrimination right at the schooling stage itself where, you know, it's, what is the irony here where more girls are going to schools but not in the workforce?
Well, this is a great contradiction of India at this moment, you know, a rising education level and reducing female workforce participation. I think we have to look at the quality of education, really. Is our education producing employable people? And really, the employment problem that you, sir, spoke about is also because of this lack of quality in education we have. We see every year, girls, you know, outperform boys in school, yeah? But then in college, many of them don't go to college, of course. Of course, college, then there is the gender division that starts happening. So, you know, engineering colleges, there'll be many more men than women and so on that'll happen. But women do check out, and this is a term that's increasingly coming up, checking out. You know, girls check out of college, they check out of university, they check out of workplaces. Because those institutions are also patriarchal. So we have to really try and change the culture of those institutions and make them less patriarchal so girls don't check out like this. They're not in their favor at any point.
Right. Yeah. There's one woman at the back and then we'll take one more question here and I think we're out. Can we get the mic here in the first row, please?
I'd like to know the panel's view on women in combat roles.
Yeah.
So recently, the Indian Army Chief made a comment on why we don't have women in combat roles as of now. So,
who wants to take this?
I can take that because we work with the Defence Forces quite a bit. Yes, it's true that we don't have as many women in combat front-ending roles because, again, for a set of perceptions on what women can do and what women can't and the conditions that women can weather and can't. But I think a lot of women are busy combating other things otherwise. So they're not at the forefront, but I think I'm very, very delighted that based on the work that UN Women has done with the Defence Forces, the Indian Army has increased its allocation
to bringing in more women in front-ending roles in combat lines, and also training other forces, such as the BSF, other paramilitary forces, for bringing more women in.
And I'd, you know, just also like to believe that the armies of the future are going to be armies with the mind and AI and a whole different subset of technology and process, which would be a big equalizer.
Yeah, absolutely.
You've spoken a little bit about changing the culture of a workplace and bringing men into the conversation. I want to ask, what does that look like, and what do particularly male targeted interventions actually look like? Yeah.
I think a more equal workplace doesn't even need that kind of elaboration. But definitely, if we allow men to partake in other parts of their family life and work life and do other things and have interests and hobbies and not just sit at work till 11, I think they'd function better at work. So it really is important. I think organizational culture is absolutely key in encouraging men to do that. And once you do, it allows them to be better at home. Absolutely. But you have to do that in a way that equalizes. I can give you a small example. When I was in the corporate sector, every time when a woman would go pick up their daughter from some class, everybody around would be like, oh, yeah, fine. Where were you? I went to pick up my daughter. Oh, yeah, sure. If it was a man who would say, oh, I went to pick up my daughter from a ballet class, there would be an audience of 50 people going, oh my God, that's so sweet.
Sorry, I think we have to wrap up the
session.
Yes,
absolutely. Yeah.
So I think that's the difference that we need to make.
Yeah. So when a woman quits her full-time job to look after the family, she's just another mom. When a man does that, he's a superhero. I think the reality has to be somewhere in the middle. And I'm very sorry, we're all out of time. I have such a brilliant panel. And such a diverse panel, right, from rural to corporate to UN women and the glamour industry. Please do catch them and ask them questions if you can after the session. Thank you. And go home and make a cup of tea if you're a guy.
And sorry, Nishtha.